Welcome to this event on wetland securing freshwater for all. We are going to show a video and then we're going to start the session.
Drinking, cooking, watering, irrigating our crops. So many everyday actions, which may seem trivial. Things that we do almost mechanically. However, water does not flow from the tap by magic. It has a source, a nurturing mother, wetlands. These natural reservoirs act as storage areas, natural purifiers. These natural filters clean water, making it potable, fit for our consumption. We tend to focus on the idea that most of the planet is water, oceans, rivers. True. But only 2.5% of the planet's water is fresh water, and less than 1% is usable. We must cherish these wetlands. They are the key to maintaining a delicate planetary balance, to preserving both fauna and flora. There are many ways to ensure the preservation of wetlands. It starts with appreciation of the functions and value wetlands provide. We must stop destroying wetlands and take action to restore them. Practicing water efficiency reduces threats to wetlands. For everything is connected, a small part of a great whole. Inseparable, water, wetlands, and life.
Good morning, good evening. I'm very pleased to welcome you to this panel session. I am Marta Rojas Urrego, the Secretary General of the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands. And we are joining today to discuss wetlands securing fresh water for all. This is a very timely and important theme as we are facing a growing water crisis. And this has consequences in everything that we do. In fact, we think that we have a lot of water, but actually only 1% of the existing water is usable. So we need this water that comes and it's stored mainly in the wetlands of the world, for example, in rivers, lakes, swamps, marshes. So in this event, we're going to discuss what is this role of these ecosystems in securing that we have fresh water. So we are organizing this event at the eve of World Wetlands Day, which is the 2nd of February, tomorrow. And we have this date in which all the parties of the convention, 171 stakeholders, the public, celebrate the Day of Wetlands. And this theme, this year, we're going to be focusing on the theme of freshwater and how it is linked with these important ecosystems. This is also a very important occasion because this year we are celebrating the 50th anniversary of the convention. This was the first global multilateral agreement for conservation that was signed in 1971 in Ramsar in Iran. So today we are very pleased to have a panel of distinguished delegates who are going to be sharing with us different perspectives on this link between wetlands and water. I'm going to have the pleasure of moderating this event, and we are going to organize it in three sessions. A first session where we are going to look at the status of trends of the world's freshwater ecosystems and how these links to the need and the SDG, the Sustainable Development Goal, that talks about the objective that we have as an international community to ensure water availability for all. Then the second session is going to be about the enabling environment and the fundamental drivers to transforming our sustainable use to ensure that we can ensure the availability of this important resource. And the third session is going to go into some particular and specific examples of different actors that have been working and that have evidence on how we can make this link. So with this, I'm going to start with session one. And I have the pleasure to introduce our speakers. So we have Kellyanne Naylor, who's the Vice Chair of UN Water, and she's the Associate Director for Water Sanitation and Hygiene in UNICEF. UN Water gets together all the UN agencies that have to do with water. So we are very pleased to have Kellyanne with us. We have Dr. Anne Larigauderie, who is the Executive Secretary of the Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, IPBES, who is the intergovernmental panel that assesses the status of biodiversity and ecosystem services. And we have Professor Lei Guanchung, who is the chair of the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands Technical Panel, the STRP, the Scientific Technical Review Panel of the Convention. So welcome. I hope that everybody then is now able to see our speakers, our colleagues who are going to be discussing with us and sharing their perspectives. So I'm going to start with Kellyanne. So Kellyanne, we consume at least 10 billion tons of fresh water daily, and by 2050, we will require 55% more. So can you tell us a little bit about the status and trends of consumption of fresh water and how this has been, what is the level and the status in different parts of the world and how this affects us as a community?
Great, Marta. Thank you so much. And it's such a pleasure to be here today from snowy New York City. So good morning to everyone. I think just to share some perspectives from UN Water, kind of going back to 2018, when World Water Day focused on nature-based solutions, one of the most shared messages in the digital space was around wetlands. And it conveyed that although there'd been a 60% decline since the 1900s, a large part of wetlands could be restored. And I think many of our partners and our members and our followers were surprised that this message still gets a lot of traction. And to me, this means that we need to keep repeating the simple fact that many of the solutions to today's water challenges can be found in nature. I think perhaps it's really too long that we've turned to human-built infrastructure to improve water management and brushed aside indigenous and local knowledge that embraces greener approaches. Turning now, Marta, to your question, I think, we're really 6 years into the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And I think, we're all seeing evidence that environmental damage together with climate change is driving water-related crises. And I think, fortunately, since we've really adopted the SDGs, countries have started to re-examine nature-based solutions. And I think when we look at the report from last year's UN Water's Integrated Monitoring Initiative for SDG 6, we collected data on all of the 11 SDG 6 indicators. And this gives us a clear view of where progress is being made, but also where the challenges lie. And I think just as you asked a few statistics from this, less than 50% of domestic wastewater is safely treated, and data is only available in one third of the countries. So this is one important starting point in terms of water pollution. A second fact that came out from this monitoring effort was that 2.3 billion people live in water-stressed countries. This is a staggering percentage of the world's population. We found that 129 countries are not on track to have sustainably managed water resources by 2030. And we also found that all of this is coming at a time when future official development assistance commitments to the water sector are down by almost 10%. So I think really when it comes to ecosystems, one-fifth of the world's river basins are experiencing rapid changes in the areas covered by surface water. However, amidst all of this, I think the good news is that almost all countries' freshwater data is now available for surface water, mangroves, wetlands, and water quality and large lakes. So I think in these findings, we can see a clear opportunity to build back better, or as many are saying now, build better forward for more resilient future. We must get the world on track to deliver these 2030 development goals, including SDG 6, which is going to contribute to so many development objectives. I think, Martha, just to close, in UN Water, we really, we not only think and believe, but we know that nature-based solutions have the potential to solve so many of our water challenges. And as you may know, in June last year, we launched at the UN High-level political forum, UN Water, together with the UN Secretary General, launched the SDG 6 Global Acceleration Framework to mobilize joint action across government, civil society, the private sector, and the UN community. As a global community, we have looked at what it takes to go further and faster, and we've identified five areas that we call accelerators. So I join all of you to look at this SDG 6 acceleration framework. There is so much more that we can do with green infrastructure, replenishing forests, connecting rivers to floodplains, and of course, restoring wetlands. We hope that this framework will help us drive rapid change together. And we see this already starting with initiatives and discussions like the very one we're having today. So wishing you very much a fruitful discussion and happy World Wetlands Day from UN Water members and partners. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kellyanne. I think that all these statistics are very impressive because they show on the one hand side how much we need water and how water is really decreasing. And the numbers that you give are really quite strong. And I think that what I'm taking from your comments, Kellyanne, is really how wetlands can be part of the solution. And that by conserving wetlands, you are also contributing to meeting these important objectives that the international community set in the Sustainable Development Agenda. And thank you for sharing this the SDG Global Acceleration Action Agenda. We are part of that, and we are very pleased to be part of that, but this shows how we need to get together to get more action. So now turning to Anne. So Anne, the IBES has been quite important in terms of showing the data and the situation and the loss of biodiversity and the services that they provide for water, but for many other of the needs of humanity. So, What is the impact that you have seen of the current freshwater consumption on the health of the ecosystems and on the services that they provide? And what are the key drivers that you have identified that explain and allow us to take action to deal with this loss?
Thank you very much, Martha, and greetings to everyone. I would first like to wish Ramsar a very happy birthday. Noting that in spite of all of our collective efforts around the world, including under the Ramsar Convention, the IBES Global Assessment established that wetlands have been on a very severe declining trend globally, particularly over the last 50 years since they've lost 85% of their total area compared to pre-industrial times, and they are losing species faster than other ecosystems, sometimes five times more. We know, for example, that there are 40% of amphibian species that are threatened with extinction. So you asked what the direct drivers of these declines in freshwater ecosystems have been. So there are five direct causes. The first one is land use change, agriculture in particular, which occupies a third of the planet's surface and uses three quarters of available freshwater resources. That is enormous. We know that leads to degradation, fragmentation, and loss of freshwater habitats. The construction of dams can also be seen as another form of land use, and that causes major hydrological disturbances. The second direct driver is the overexploitation of resources. The third one is pollution in all of its forms, including from agriculture, fertilizers, pesticides, but also chemicals. Over 80% of our global wastewater every year are discharged back into the environment without treatment, and that includes heavy metals, toxic wastes. Climate change is the fourth direct driver. We know that it leads to shifts in species distribution, local extinction. We know that freshwater ecosystems store large amounts of carbon. And fifth is invasive alien species. So you are asking what the consequences of this loss of wetlands is for people. And the IBES Global Assessment first talks about these non-material contributions. Those are the sense of belonging, of place, of identity, but also recreational contributions. These have been on a declining trend, but there are also other forms of contributions. Food, of course, for humans, since freshwater provide about 40% of global fish production worldwide, but also food and habitat for non-human species, particularly migratory birds. I've mentioned that they contribute to climate regulation by storing carbon in particular, but also, and importantly, they regulate the quality and the quantity of fresh water. So in terms of quality, wetlands regulate by filtering pollutants or nitrates from agriculture. They account for 20% worldwide of global denitrification, so that's a major role. And then in terms of, and we've seen that the quality of fresh water has declined globally. Today, about 40% of the global population lacks access to clean and safe drinking water. And there are projections that increased in algal blooms that are toxic, resulting from fertilizer, as well as pathogens in the water, will further increase the health of people. And then finally, in terms of quantity, freshwater ecosystems regulate water quantity, largely thanks to the effects of the vegetation on flow speed, and deforestation and urbanization are increasing this runoff quantity and the flow speed, and they are threatening the quantity of available freshwater. So in a nutshell, that is really a quick dive into the drivers and into how that affects the services that people derive from all of these freshwater ecosystems. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. You have provided a quite clear picture of the current trends of loss and highlighting that this is the ecosystem that is most threatened. We are losing it faster than many others, and perhaps this is something that not everybody is aware of. And at the same time, you made a very strong case of the services. And I heard, you know, the importance, for example, in terms of the quality of water, and you mentioned how billions of people are exposed to water that is not ready or good for consumption, and how wetlands can also be a solution for that. So clearly it's a picture of big loss, big services. So with this, I would like to turn to Professor Lay, because in the convention, our panel has been looking, of course, with more detail about what is happening in wetlands, and we have been part of the assessments of IBES, of course. So Professor Lay, the impact that we have heard is quite impressive, because we have lost 90% of the wetlands since 1700. So this means that we have very little left from the original surface of this ecosystem. So what are the urgent policy actions that need to be taken to reverse this trend?
Thank you very much for offering this opportunity to talk on behalf of STRT. I think it's well documented that conservation and restoration of degraded wetlands are the nature-based solutions to freshwater crisis. Therefore, development of national policy and legislation that prevent any further loss of natural wetlands and promote effective restoration of wetland ecosystems has been a common practice of Ramsar contracting parties. The Ramsar Convention has always recognized the interdependence between people, water resources, and wetland ecosystems. The preambular text of the convention refers to the fundamental ecological function of the wetlands as the regulators of water regimes. Article 2 of the convention states the wetlands should be selected into the list on the account of their international significance in terms of ecology, botany, geology, limnology, or hydrology. In the development of the Ramsar Convention in the past half century, more than 10 resolutions and guidelines directly related to water and wetland has been adopted by contracting parties. Therefore, implementation of the Ramsar Convention, application of nature-based solution for wetland ecosystem restoration, setting and enforce conservation and restoration targets by all contracting parties will be the key to mitigate such freshwater crisis. So my second recommendation is to develop a package of a mechanism that supports science-based management of wetlands and water resources. The recently released fifth edition of the Global Biodiversity Outlook from CBD suggests a sustainable freshwater transition is needed to guarantee water flows required by nature and people, improving water quality, protecting critical habitats, controlling invasive species, and safeguarding connectivity to allow the recovery of freshwater systems from the mountain to the sea. A sustainable freshwater transition requires either removal of the artificial boundary between environmental sector, the water sector, and other relevant sectors, or very close cooperation between environment, water, and related sectors. The Ramsar Convention offered a package of technical tools and guidelines to help contracting parties develop a mechanism to support ecosystem management, integrated river-based management, payment for ecosystem services, water pricing, polluters pay, river-based institutional capacity building, and public participation in monitoring, evaluation, and decision making. Such a package of mechanisms can be expanded according to the need of each contracting parties to ensure wetlands remain as an important source of fresh water. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lei. It was very useful to hear also what has been done under the convention. And I think that this resonates with what we heard before also from Anne and Kellyanne. And what really strikes me is that we have the science. I mean, of course, there are many things that we still don't know, but we know sufficient about the importance of conserving these ecosystems, the trends and the numbers that are very worrying, and how they contribute to very critical aspects of human life. I would think that for everything, for consumption, for development, we need to have these ecosystems healthy so that they contribute and provide the services that we heard in great detail. And you mentioned some of the actions that may be taken. So I would like to thank the panelists for this first session. I think that what I'm hearing from all of you is that we have the science, that we have the numbers, the evidence is quite strong, and I think that we need to do a better job of communicating this what is happening with wetlands and how they are part of the solution. what I'm hearing very strongly from the three participants is how they are nature-based solutions to ensure that we have the water in the quantity and in the quality that we need. And that one of the key actions is how can we integrate wetlands within the different policies and the different actions. Kellyanne mentioned infrastructure, so they need to be part of all the policies for water management. So integration, nature-based solutions, and the status and what we know seem to be quite important messages coming out from this session. So I would like to thank the three of you, and we are going to now move to our session two, in which we are going to be looking at the enabling environment and the drivers that are absolutely key to transitioning to sustainable use of freshwater ecosystems. So we're taking another perspective, which is to see what do we need, what are the underlying issues that we can address in order to ensure freshwater for all. And here, I'm very pleased to introduce our speakers. So we have first of all, Tina Bimpili, who is the Deputy Executive Secretary of the United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification. We have David Cooper, who is the Deputy Executive Secretary of the UN Convention on Biological Diversity. And we have Henk Hovink, who is the Special Envoy for International Water Affairs for the Kingdom of the Netherlands and a very active actor in all the water discussions. So with this, in this session where we are going to look at this enabling environment, I would like to start with Tina. So Tina, thank you for being with us, our sister convention that deals with the certification. So the convention on the certification has been dealing with land use, which is a critical factor for the conservation of all ecosystems. And it's a determinant on whether we conserve or we degrade our wetlands. And the certification convention has been working since its signing in Rio in helping contracting parties on how can they combat desertification and restore drylands as well as other ecosystems like wetlands to ensure that we can get the benefits that we need, you know, like for our economy and well-being. So Tina, I would like to hear from the experience of the desertification convention. Can you tell us what are the findings? What are some examples that could show this interlinkage between land and wetlands and the services that they provide?
Thank you very much, Martha. And thank you very much for inviting me to take part in this panel. First of all, I would like to say, and I hope that you are all well, all the parties of the Ramsar Convention and the stakeholders are healthy and resilient as we navigate into a very difficult 2021. I will mention specific examples, and I will start by saying that the UNCCD, the key focus that we have under our plan until 2030 is to help nations achieve land degradation neutrality. This is also one of the indicators of the sustainable development goals. And basically what we are trying to do in the land degradation neutrality target that more than 130 countries have committed to, the Secretariat is trying to assist those countries in designing and implementing an integrated response, which is protect, manage, and restore. With this response, and this is of course three words that I think they are quite, the one is quite close to the other. There are numerous strategies and practices that can increase also water conservation and water use efficiency. First, what we're trying to do with this land degradation neutrality project is to protect existing wetlands and watersheds by managing or restoring their soil and the vegetation, by creating protected areas, riparian buffer zones, and reducing soil erosion. The second part of this project is to manage the production landscapes through sustainable agronomic and forestry practices, in order to improve the water holding capacity of the soils and also enhance the carbon and the biodiversity. I don't want to dwell more on that, but just to say that all these modern technologies that can be used, especially for agriculture and also for micro irrigation, can hold a great potential for sustainable land management, but also for keeping the young farmers and the land managers, if they wish to do so, in the rural areas and not having everybody moving to the urban environment. So these sort of rural-urban interactions and interlinkages is something that the UNCCD is trying to look more carefully at. A second example is connected to the Great Green Wall. This is a flagship program in the Sahel area. We are very proud of it, and we hope that this example can be replicated to other regions with adjusted to their own circumstances. Very recently, at the recent One Planet Summit, which was organized by the French presidency, there was the launch of the Great Green Wall Accelerator Initiative. And basically, with this initiative, countries have committed tens of billions of dollars over the next years to meet the target of restoring 100 million hectares by 2030. And of course, when we are talking about restoring the land in the Sahel, we're also talking about restoring the blue lines, the blue lifelines, as we call them, which is basically the water of the area, the wetlands of the area. Now, just to finish off with these two examples, and I could go on also on our work that we're trying to do on drought, I would just like to say that, just to add a bit of numbers in the numbers that have been shared, that we have evidence that economic rates of return from 12% to over 40% have been found for several land restoration and management projects, of course, including soil and water restoration. But apart from that, which is the sort of the top line financials, I think that the UNCCD, we believe that healthy land is for healthy people. And I think that this is not a slogan, but it's a message that we convey, that our parties convey in their interactions, especially now that we are discussing about how we can build forward better after the COVID pandemic. And basically how we can use land also as a means to assist in the building back better. Thank you very much. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tina. It's really very interesting to see this linkage between land and water, because when we think about desertification and the loss of land, which is one of the big problems that we face, it is very much linked, as you were saying, with these blue lines that are absolutely like part and parcel of the desertification or the restoration process. And you mentioned the importance of restoration, which I think is a very important message that has been also mentioned in the previous session. And the importance of then conserving and restoring key ecosystems, as well as working on the production systems. I'm also hearing that this makes economic sense. So it's not a conservation agenda. It's really, you showed about rates of return and how it makes economic sense to take this type of integrated approaches. And with this, I would like to turn now to David. So David, in addition, we have talked about water for livelihoods, for agriculture, for consumption, but wetlands are also very important as a habitat for and as part of biodiversity. We know that 40% of the world species either breed or live in wetlands. So as a convention that is leading on biodiversity, and of course we work very closely with you, what are the messages and findings from this big assessment that you did, the Global Biodiversity Outlook, regarding these contributions of wetlands to the biodiversity agenda, and how is it that the new framework that is being negotiated across and among all the countries of the world to have a framework with indicators for biodiversity. How do you see that this is going to contribute to better conservation of these ecosystems, more availability for water for all, and turning the curve of the degradation of biodiversity?
Well, thanks very much, Marta, and congratulations also on the 50th anniversary of the Ramsar Convention. It's a real pleasure to be here with you and Tina and Henk and the other panelists, and happy World Water Day tomorrow to everyone. Yes, well, as you've just outlined, and as has been apparent, I think, for many of the panelists so far this today, wetlands and freshwater valuable for biodiversity and for people. As you've just noted, wetlands provide the habitat for something like 40% of species, even though they occupy just 1% of the land of the planet's area, and they provide so many essential ecosystem services, which are becoming even more important in the era of climate change. So flood control, erosion control, removing some pollutants, excess nutrients from our water, and so on. And of course, climate mitigation. But of course, most obviously, and the focus today, they provide water, and they ensure that both the quality and the quantity of that water. And as Tina was saying also, they provide these blue lines across the landscape. So they, in fact, are connecting all of the ecosystems from mountains through the land to the oceans. And so what happens in wetlands and what happens in freshwater systems is important also for the oceans, especially coastal areas. And of course, as Tina was just outlining, what happens on land is really important for wetlands. Despite all this, we know they're the most impacted of ecosystems. We've lost more wetlands than most other types of ecosystems. So many rivers have been fragmented, and the decline in the abundance of species is greater in freshwater systems than in terrestrial or marine. So clearly, if we're to meet this 2050 vision of living in harmony with nature, if we're going to achieve the SDGs, SDG 6, but also all of the SDGs actually, then we need to reverse these trends. And what we set out in the Global Biodiversity Outlook, the fifth edition, which was launched last year, as you mentioned, is some elements of what we call a sustainable freshwater transition. And there are really three main things which would directly help to support the quality and quantity of freshwater. And the first really is to make sure that the ecosystems themselves are guaranteed a fair share, so to speak, of the flows of water. At the moment, so much water is diverted for industrial use, for domestic use, and above all, agricultural use. Some countries like South Africa and Mexico have begun to put in place policies and laws to correct this. And secondly, of course, we need to control pollution. We've heard about wastewater, and of course, excess nutrients from agriculture is also crucial for wetlands and in turn for coastal areas. And we need to protect, and because we've lost so much, we need to restore those wetlands. We will also need to control invasive alien species, which are particularly troublesome in wetlands, as well as overfishing, especially as fish are so important for the nutrition for many, many people, and among them, some of the poorest people. In the most of these issues are reflected, as you'll know, in the zero draft of the post-2020 global biodiversity framework and the updated zero draft that was released in August. As you know, the framework is being negotiated under the auspices of the CBD, but is intended to be a framework for everyone. And yes, we're working very closely with Ramsar, the other biodiversity related conventions, the desertification convention, and others to develop a framework that will be, that we hope will provide a universal framework of goals and targets for biodiversity over the next 10 years. Some of the draft targets in that framework, these action targets, of course, address each of the main drivers of biodiversity loss, including loss of freshwater systems. And Anne, I mentioned these, I think, in the first panel. But there's also a specific target on nature-based solutions, on using wetlands as, if you like, natural infrastructure for improving specifically the quality and quantity of freshwater among other ecosystems. There will need to be major investments, obviously, in conservation and restoration to get there. But also, equally importantly, there will need to be a mainstreaming of these issues into other sectors. And in particular, we'll need to see transformation of the food and agricultural sectors, moving towards more sustainable agriculture in order to limit the expansion of agriculture and in fact provide space for restoration in order to avoid the runoff from nutrients and the like. We'll also need to look at urban planning and everything else. We have the opportunity actually right now with the COVID recovery packages to begin to move in the right direction. And then we hope that the framework that will be adopted in Kunming, hopefully later this year, will spur all of the action that we all need, all working together to secure freshwater and wetlands and wetland biodiversity for the future. Thanks.
Thank you, David. I think that your messages were very clear, not only on the status, but also on what needs to be done. I think that it came out and de-joining with what we have heard from the other speakers on, we know what needs to be done, and we have great opportunities with the Sustainable Development Agenda, now with the Global Biodiversity Framework being negotiated and the convention and what the parties are doing under the convention on wetlands and other conventions are contributing to this. And you highlighted also, we have talked a lot about the contributions of wetlands for people, but you highlighted also the importance of ensuring that there are environmental flows also for nature. So it's how to get that balance right. So you also talked, and we have heard other participants, including Tina, talk about building back better. So we are, you know, like in the middle of this pandemic. And as you say, there are many efforts in terms of how to restart the economy and what world we're going to have after this unprecedented crisis. So with this, I would like to turn to Henk, because you have been also very involved in this discussion. And what I would like to ask you is, what do you think are fundamental actions that we need to transition towards a more sustainable management and use of freshwater and the ecosystems that are so important for making this water available at the quality and quantity that we need?
Thank you so much, Martha. And of course, congratulations already for tomorrow, but also on all the work you're doing with your partners. You can take real pride. At the same time, in the context of the development, what we see, we all know that the decline in wetlands is not something of the last 100, but something of the last 300 or more years. And climate change is only increasing. I want to refer to the IPCC report that is often overlooked, which is the Climate Change and Land Report, because the two pillars of that report are, of critical importance on how inform how we move ahead. On one, it says the majority of what we do, our investments, is actually increasing climate change. So we pollute, carbon emission, lack of biodiversity, increasing footprint, et cetera, et cetera. So more climate change. But the second pillar of the report says how we do it, how we develop our cities, our economies, our agriculture, is done in the wrong way, making us less resilient and more vulnerable, and in the wrong places, destroying our natural capital. And this disbalance, this double whammy on how we act as humankind, we have to overcome. Looking at the SDGs, and every time at the HLPF, we look back and ahead, we say we're not on track. We're not on track on our SDGs, and we're not on track on our climate agreement. And if we look at nature in the context of the biodiversity decline, which is caused by us, two, it is again, like the climate change and land report says, increasing climate change and a reduction of our resiliency, our sustainable capacity. So investing in nature is the way forward to securing water security, not only for freshwater, not only for biodiversity, but also for a resilient economy and sustainable societies. And we see it around the world. So why am I, this is like the doom and gloom start, which we all understand, but this is also the challenge. We know the massive need and the enormous tasks on our shoulders. We drafted 17 sustainable development goals as a holistic agenda, not something to cherry pick from, although we see it happening all over the world. We have a Paris Agreement, and we're only 5-6 years after that, moving towards 2030 very, very fast. So we have to rapidly act, but there is hope, because we see many cases around the world where partnerships, and I think this is where this contribution is about, the enabling environment becomes critically important. And water is amazing for that, because water connects us all. Water is for health, it's for economy, it's for biodiversity, the environment, it's for mitigation in climate, it's for adaptation to climate. It's for security, it's against, it's for gender, for education. Women and kids walk the wells. With water security, women progress communities far better than men. So on and on, investing in water has a trickle-down effect across all sustainable development goals. And that is what we see happening around the world. Many examples, but there are still drops on a hot plate. So if we look at the context of the COVID recovery, we see that there is a massive effort of investing trillions of dollars or euros or yen or whatever currency, trillions of dollars around the world going into recovery with a very short-term, single-focused effort. And that means stupid infrastructure, making us more vulnerable instead of more sustainable and resilient. Okay, they will offer jobs on the short term, but not on the long run. They won't help us change course. So it is on us as a global community that understands this complexity, knows how to value nature and water, that we can start to manage this, bringing these best examples that we have to scale. I only name one. It's an example in Chennai where we built with a local community capacity institutionally with the government and international financiers. And it turns out that with nature-based solutions, we curb carbon. Investments are a third less, and maintenance and operations only half of the cost. And we secure water security for the whole community and have the capacity to scale this up. So those solutions, those opportunities by partnership, there are many around the world, but it is on us to take the leadership to bring them together, scale them up and replicate. So I think the solution lies in nature and in our collaborative capacity as human beings and our institutions to come together. Water is the enabler to bring us together and become a real catalyst for the change we need. But we have to stick to our promise. And I think that is the challenging part. Don't repeat the mistakes from the past. Shy away from investing in stupid infrastructure. I in the Netherlands just wrote an op-ed and say, ban investments that go to the infrastructure that make us more vulnerable. And the proof of that should be with the investor. Show that whatever dollar you put in place, public and private, is making the world better instead of less. The climate change and land report of the IPCC is like a trajectory on how to change course, and all the good work you're doing around the world is too. So thanks so much, and look forward to next steps, inspiring next steps to take the world on a better track.
Thank you, Henk. You have, as usual, you are very, very, you bring, you know, this idea of the urgency to take action that we know when it's to be done. I think that you are bringing also a very important concept, which is the importance of this discussion that we are having on the resilience and sustainability of what we do. And clearly with the pandemic crisis and all the investments that are being made, it's either we continue on the same path that we know is going to take us to putting ourselves in danger, right, or we take the opportunity to change the way that we think about nature within these investments, yeah, to really make a change. So thank you for this very down-to-earth and strong message. So I would like to thank the three of you for a very interesting discussion, where I think that many of you converged in talking about this connection and how water and wetlands are connectors between different agendas. It's with land, with oceans, it's with biodiversity, and how investing in the conservation of these ecosystems is going to contribute not only to SDG 6 and water availability, but for other SDGs and other, because the SDGs are really the promises and the commitments for a society that is more fair and more efficient in terms of providing what everybody in the world, everywhere in the world needs. So I think that these messages have been very important, and also highlighting the opportunities that we have with agendas like the SDGs, like the emerging global biodiversity framework for the post-2020, as well as Tina mentioned some very concrete initiatives that show that we can collaborate and that it's possible. And as Henk concluded, it's not that we don't know what to do, it's really the will and the determination to do it. So thank you very much for this. Before turning to the third session, I wanted to invite those who are participating as viewers of this event. There is a possibility to write in the chat other examples or initiatives that you're aware of that you know contribute to the conservation of wetlands and to the services that they provide, and how, you know, by doing this, we are also contributing to water availability and addressing water security. So with this, I'm going to move now to the session 3. So thank you to our panelists to session 2. And this session, what we would like is to hear other concrete initiatives and examples that are leading the way to a more sustainable freshwater management for people and for nature. And I'm very, very pleased to introduce our speakers. So we are going to be hearing examples from different perspectives, starting by Eric Souberain, who's the Vice President for Nature and the Water Cycle in Danone. Camille Yepang, who is working in IUCN in one of the regional programs. And Eugenio Barrios, who is a policy manager in Mexico, who has worked with the government and has been leading some of the efforts of this country to address water and people. So with this, I would like then to turn to Eric. So Eric, very pleased to have you with us. So Danone is a company that has been leading food and beverage companies around the world. And we have been working very closely with Danone. We have a very long partnership. So I would like you to share, Eric, how you see and how Danone, which is a private sector company, has been transitioning to sustainable water consumption, that values and takes into account wetlands as an ecosystem that is part of the management of water. So could you please share with you what this experience has been?
Thank you very much, Marta, and happy birthday to the wetland. It's been 23 years actually that indeed the Ramsar Convention and Denon has been associated. And I think when we look back 23 years ago, probably our predecessors had really the vision that I would say the public sector and the private sector should work together and in hand. And that was a very new idea probably at that time when you think about it. And it's even more important for wetlands, and I will come back to that, because fundamentally, I think the ideas between the wetland is that it's an incredible capital, a natural capital, really per se, that I think very often is neglected and not very well understood, as many of your speakers before mentioned. And I think that's really one of the elements that for us, looking at our business being in the food and water sector, was very much clear that we are only stewarding this resource for the next generation. And the responsibility of an organization, a private organization like Danone, is of course to use the resource because it's a resource, it has a usage for the community, but the responsibility of an organization is to make sure that this resource is stewards, preserved and restored for the next generation. And this was very clear to us, I would say, first by the very local routing of our businesses. When you have a water brand, very often, what you are advocating for is the image of the region in which you are operating. When we have basically water brands like Evian, like Villa Vicencio, like Volvic, this is also the name of a municipality locally. So this local routing is very important to understand the ecosystem in which you are operating. And therefore, I would say naturally, our teams locally were, first of all, living where the water was coming from, and very conscious that protecting this resource was very essential to the capacity of the economic system to continue. And I think this very local and territorial aspect is for us very, very important in the way we approached from the very beginning the protection of water resource and therefore the wetlands on which our impluvians were located. So I think that's really the origination of this strategy. It was not a big strategy. It was really something starting from people working in our factories, in our bottling plants locally, and that were very much conscious that protecting this environment was very important. And I think that was the very first step. If we take these 20 years of partnership, that was, I would say, the nucleus at the very beginning. Then there has been a second step, which is that concretely, how do you do to protect these natural resources? And for us, I think we progressively come to the idea that this protection can only be done collectively. Okay, and I think that's really the logic also of integrating with our local ecosystems and opening up between private sector, public societies, and also farmers. And when you look at our impluvium, this is the dialogue that we are initiating. We could have taken maybe other approach. You could say, we're going to freeze basically the land, but very often where we operate, there is a life, an economic life, an agricultural life, and this is a common good that needs to be managed collectively. And I think the second step for us was really about how do we gel up together? How do we team up with local people to basically put in place a mechanism of protection and restoration of the ecosystem? I think that's the second part of our journey over the last 20 years. And this is why, Marta, we as a private company embarked with you in making the Evian Impluvium a Ramsar site. This is why we've been extremely proud also 2 years ago to celebrate together that our Villa Vicencio natural reserve, 72,000 hectares, was the first privately owned natural reserve to be Ramsar certified as well. So that's been the second step of our journey. And I think we're entering now as a private sector company in a third step of the journey, where we see that the capabilities of protecting sites becomes in itself a competitive advantage. And I think that's very interesting. I think we're only at the beginning of this journey. This is why we team up, but a lot of our consumers, citizens, society, is asking us to be transparent on our responsibility in stewarding the resource. And therefore the capacity to, I would say, make that clear, visible, becomes in itself a competitive advantage for an organization. And that's I think, the momentum in which we are. I think that's the momentum in which the decade of actions in which we are entering is going to be very much determining our capacity to act and protect. And there are, and I will stop here. I am passionate about what wetlands. I mean, it's fantastic. The multi wetlands are really, by essence, the multiple benefit that basically nature can provide. Wetlands, it's about, of course, protection of water, but it's also protection of biodiversity. It's about soil. It's about the capacity of the system to store more carbon in the soil. So that's really the ecosystem that represents the best, the multiple benefit. And I really hope that with partners that I've spoken today, with you, the Ramsar Convention, in the decades in front of us, we're going to be able to materialize this ecosystem services that wetland provide. Because if we do that, we transform the discussion from a conservation discussion to really a discussion of creating more value through more natural assets. Because one of my, being an economist and a business person, one of my intimate conviction on that is that overall the society is making a mistake looking at natural assets, because when you buy a traditional asset, the asset is depreciating over time, it's losing value. The good thing with natural asset is when you protect them, when you invest in natural asset, it's appreciating over time. So there is a collective value that you can create. And we need to invent different economic models to capture this value. And I think that's one of the things where, because wetlands have so many multiple benefits attached to that, this is an area where we can create value and therefore invent different ways of capturing it. And concretely, this is what we see in many of our wetlands today that are happening, be it in Villa Vicenzo, in Evian, in Volvic, in Indonesia, where working with people on protecting the water in the rice field, we are generating a lot of multiple benefits as well.
Thank you, Eric. It's really great that you are highlighting our history, because I think that as you said, there have been many first off, within this collaboration, including, I think, showing how for the private sector, it's in their interest to work to conserve nature. And as you said, it was really great that we had the first privately owned wetland of international importance, and it was connected with the business. I find extremely interesting how hearing you as a businessman speaking about wetlands, not only with this passion because you find them, beautiful or nice, but because you see that there is a competitive advantage for your industry to conserve these ecosystems. And you mentioned the multiple benefits, which I think is one of the themes that is coming across the discussion that we're having today. But you also talked about this opportunity to create more value through nature assets. And I think that there is a lot that can be with that. We know the important role of the private sector for the economy and for everything that we do. So hearing you is really very inspiring. And with this, I'm going to turn to Camille Yepang, Hello, Camille. Camille is going to bring a very different perspective because she's working in a regional program of IUCN. So it will be very interesting from you to hear from you, Camille, on how you have been working with this challenge of managing freshwater demand, which is increasing with declining ecosystems. So can you share some of your experiences from West Africa?
Hello, thanks, Marta. Thanks, Marta, for giving me the floor. As you said, I've been working in some years for IUCN. So I'll be talking from my experience based in West Africa and specifically in the Lake Chad Basin, where IUCN has been working for more than 15 years. So
we cannot hear you, Camille.
So I think about the different challenges, management and protection of... Hello, do you hear me, Marta? Hello, Marta, do you hear me?
We didn't hear you at the beginning, so if you could...
Oh my God. Again,
yes.
Are you okay? No, I was saying that I will be sharing my experience of my work in the West Africa and specifically in the Lake Chad Basin. So because IUCN has been working there for more than 15 years today, and I think previous speakers addressed the different challenges concerning freshwater management and protection of ecosystems. So maybe what I could add on different challenges and which are a little bit specific to the West Africa region is maybe the rapid demographic growth and weak governance and security issues, which are really big threats to the water management in our region. And if I take the case of the Lake Chad Basin, is the world sixth largest inland. And for the past four decades, the Lake Chad Basin has lost about that area, going from 25 square kilometers to 2,500 kilometers. And this had a huge impact on the life of people living in the area, because we have about 47 million people who live in the Lake Chad Basin, and that derives their livelihoods. The essence of their livelihood is based on the availability of water, because they carry out agriculture, fisheries, animal husbandries, and so the degradation of the water that really impacts their life. And the escalating degradation of the water resources and ecosystem is further exacerbated in the Lake Chad Basin by the current security challenge. Because I think it is well known over the world that we have the Boko Haram operating in that area. And it really causes migration of huge amount of people and livestock who are looking, searching for a better life and better livelihoods. So, and this has this impacts the management of the water in the Lake Chad Basin. We also have desertification and the effects of climate change, which also exacerbate the overexploitation of the natural resources in that area. And today we can also talk about the pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic, which has an impact on health and also on the economic and well-being of people living in that area. And from this challenge, I think if I want to talk about progress made by different states, I think African states, as most of the countries around the world, after the Rio, since Rio. Hello, Martha, are you hearing me? Hello? 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 Martha, do you hear me? Okay, so I was talking, hello?
We can hear you, Camille.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry. I have my internet is not very stable, so sometimes I lose. So I was talking about, I wanted to talk about steps taken by different countries to face all these challenges. So I was saying, since Rio, most national governments have adopted bold and ambitious policies and programs to address these water ecosystem threats. And in Central and West Africa, for example, we have this political engagement has been materialized through signing of transboundary agreements and also establishment of transboundary basin authority. We have, for example, the Lake Chad Basin Authority that has been established from an agreement with, between riparian countries. We have the Volta Basin Authority. We have the International Congo, Ubangi and Sanga Commission. We have the Niger Basin Authority. So we have all these transboundary basin authority that has been established from a political will or arrangement between riparian countries of these shared water resources. And adding to this, this institution, transboundary organization, we also have a legal instrument that have been adopted by these countries like Water Charter. This legal instrument is to promote equitable and sustainable water resources management between all these countries. And this country, this instrument also play a vital role into conflict prevention. And to also mention initiative at the regional level, the West and Central Africa Economic Commissions, which are ECAS and ECOWAS, it's two different commissions, have put in place some regional center to coordinate water resources to support the members country, to assist member countries in the management of the shared water. And to I think it's also important to mention an initiative at the continental level, the African Ministerial Minister Council on Water that has been established to promote cooperation, security, and poverty eradication among different member states to effectively manage the continent's water resources. And through the African Minister Council on Water, the Africa Water Facilities was put in place and which is, and it's managed by the African Development Bank. This is also a regional initiative that was put in place to support countries to finance projects and program on sustainable freshwater management across the countries. So from this political commitment, of different government and with this existing institutional and legal instrument, I think this facilitates the development and the implementation of large-scale projects by multilateral donors such as African Development Bank, World Bank, European Union. For example, in the Lake Chad Basin for the past 15 years, many projects have been funded or is currently implemented under the scheme of the Save the Lake Chad Basin. And this is to support the implementation of the strategic action plan of the Lake Chad Basin, or to support the water charter, and to support the stabilization strategies, to support the adaptation strategy that all member countries adopted. And in June 2020, for example, the World Bank launched a big project, large-scale project of $170 million to support resilience and livelihoods in the Lake Chad Basin, in the Lake Chad region. So, concerning IUCN intervention in the area, IUCN has been working for many years with the Lake Chad Basin Commission to, first of all, to strengthen capacity of local communities and to participate to the management of the basin. And I think this was through the establishment of multi-stakeholders platforms that act as change makers today into the region and into the Lake Chad Basin. I think this is a good example to promote across the basin, the entire basin, and across the region in other basin authority.
Thank you, Camille. Sorry to interrupt a little bit, but we heard all this experience that you're having, and Lake Chad is perhaps one of these places where we see this connection and how what we're discussing matters to people, especially poor people in regions of the world that are suffering from many crises, including humanitarian. So with this, I'm going to turn to Eugenio to hear from Mexico, a national experience. We know that Mexico has been very active in looking at the relationship of water with nature and with people. So can you share with us in a brief way your experience and how, you know, with this concrete example, we can further gain more understanding on this connection between wetlands, nature, and people?
Yes, of course. Thank you. Thank you very much, Marta. Well, I will share this experience with you, the Mexican experience on how we have approached wetland conservation. But I would like to start at recognizing the anniversary of the 50th anniversary of the convention on behalf of the Mexican government. And of course, to thank you for the invitation to this very, very special event. Well, this experience started around almost 50 years ago. At that time, we were losing wetlands on an alarming rate, as it was mentioned in the previous sessions. The country was suffering, and is still suffering in some parts, a severe water over extraction and a serious loss of freshwater biodiversity. At that time, we can say that we had two countries. We were facing two countries. One country that was overexploited, and the other that where water was still available, but following the same path. We focus on this second country, where we were still on time to set limits and to plan how water extraction could be in the future. At that time, allocating water for the environment was an unthinkable task. Even it was considered in the water law, there were no tools, no procedures, even the willingness to do it, it was difficult to find. It's completely different from what is happening right now. Water for the environment was at the end of the list, competing and waiting to have some voice. Water resource management was the main cause of this wetland degradation, but at the same time, we realized that it was the main solution. Then at the time, we started a project that we call Develop of New Water Management Models in Mexico, aiming to resolve the protection of water for the environment. The project was, at that time, was led by WWF with a multi-stakeholder platform. And the goal was to position water for the environment at the core of the water management process. And therefore, a goal for all water users and the society. Technically speaking, we developed environmental flow assessments and then agree upon a water reserve for the environment with the authority and the stakeholders. Starting with those basins where the water was still available, this second country, let's say it, became the perfect learn by doing a scenario that helped to accelerate and scale up the implementation process. Water reserves is a very interesting concept nowadays. It's a volume of water estimated by an e-flow assessment that is taken out of the water allocation process to avoid overexploitation and hydrological disruption. Currently in Mexico, almost 300 river basins are protected. Overall, we have 756 river basins, and 300 are protected, covering 41 Ramsar sites, around 2 million hectares, and 60 natural protected areas, covering almost 8 million hectares. The water reserves in Mexico are protecting almost half of the total annual surface water runoff. That's a huge amount of water. And it represents direct benefits for near 40 million people. Based on this experience, we took the next steps. And now water for wetlands is a priority in our agenda. Current administration has just published the new National Water Plan, the National Water Program, 2020-2024, that includes for the first time water budgets for all the basins and aquifers in the country with the specific volumes for water, for the environment and for the people. E-flows are now one of the four welfare goals established in the National Water Program. And it is proposed to reach 450 river basins in the following years. In this process, we have realized how important it is to transform water resource management from focusing only on water extraction to managing the water that is needed in the environment. This water is played an essential function for the water, even for the water managers themselves. It means a buffer to handle uncertainties. Water for the environment means a stock of ecosystem services, the foundation of nature-based solutions, and a key element for adaptation to climate change, resilience, risk management, and water security. We cannot deal with any of these solutions in the future if water is not protected in our wetlands. But perhaps the most important lesson of all this process is to understand water resource management as a powerful driver to conserve and restore freshwater habitats, and thus stop and reverse the severe loss of biodiversity we're facing in the planet. In 2015, at the conference of the party in Punta del Este, Uruguay, in Mexico presented the resolution 12, that is a call to action to ensure and protect the water requirements of wetlands for the present and the future. Well, today more than ever, it's important to refresh this call and take emergency actions to scale up and accelerate wetlands and biodiversity conservation and restoration. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very, very much, Eugenio. I think that this is very useful to take a very practical perspective of what a country has done and how, you know, like linking wetlands, water, nature, people is possible in a very concrete way. So it is also, I think, very interesting to see how a national example can then be used by others and how it becomes international policy, as you mentioned. This experience of Mexico was then reflected in a resolution that the 171 contracting parties of the convention took. So it is really useful to see in this panel how from different perspectives, from the private sector, from a non-governmental organization working at the regional level, and then a national policy taken by a government in partnership with other stakeholders can show, you know, how practically this connection exists, what solutions there are, what measures exist and are available to be replicated, and this including both the public sector, which is a main focus, of course, of the type of conventions that we are, but also of the private sector with which we are collaborating even more intensely, and not only because of the role in development, but also because of this connection that we heard, you know, exists between the business model and the conservation of these ecosystems. So with this, I would like to thank the three panelists. And this has been a very interesting conversation. I have enjoyed it. I hope that all the participants and those joining us have obtained as much as possible information about this important issue. And I would like to highlight some points that I heard in the conversation, starting by what we know and we heard from the first session, but also throughout, that we know what is the status of wetlands, that we know that they are threatened and it's the most threatened ecosystem. We heard about the water crisis and that we are increasingly requiring more water for all our economic activities. It is a question of agriculture development, but also health, livelihoods. You know, we heard how many people are faced with the water that is not good for consumption. But we also heard that there is a close relationship between these needs and what these ecosystems can provide. So we heard about wetlands being nature-based solutions that could help deal with these big challenges that we have in all parts of the world. We heard nature-based solutions. I also heard about multiple benefits, and I think that this is important to reflect as well. Another message that I would like to highlight is this question of connections. And we heard, you know, the connections with land, with the desertification, with oceans, with gender, with biodiversity. One of the speakers said that water connects all, and it's an enabler also for us to take more integrated actions. Another key message that I heard is that it makes economic sense. This is not a conservation agenda of those of us, you know, like who work on the environmental sector. It's something that is important for disaster risk reduction, climate change, for companies such as Danone. We heard that it makes economic sense also from our contributor from the desertification convention. We heard that it helps, you know, like in building competitive advantage of companies and to create more value through nature assets. And we also heard measures, very concrete, so we know what works. I think that a key word there is integration. How can we integrate wetlands in all our development efforts as infrastructure, green infrastructure? An important point was also about building back better. We are in this pandemic, and it was very interesting to hear the opportunity of, you know, what choice are we going to take? Continuing the same path or really changing what needs to be changed to have a more resilient and sustainable future? There are some opportunities that we heard internationally, the Global Biodiversity Framework, the Sustainable Development Agenda. We heard about regional initiatives like the Great Green Wall. We heard about partnerships. But I would like perhaps to finish by mentioning the sense of urgency that we also heard of, you know, we need to ensure that we have a resilient and sustainable development. And there is an urgency to rapidly act. We also heard some comments in the chat that I would like just to very briefly refer to. One is the need to capture the economic value of wetlands, to protect them with adequate funding that one of the participants mentioned. We also heard that local communities and stakeholders need to be included and can assist in restoring wetlands, that more cooperation is needed across all sectors and organizations, and especially those that depend on water and wetlands. We heard also from South Africa that increasing public awareness and getting them on board would help in policy and governance. And also that in cooperation with citizen science, we can monitor and have tools into regional and national monitoring protocols that can go a long way and involve citizens in these efforts. And finally, we heard of many examples of actors that are advocating for law to protect wetlands. So with this, I mean, we have had a great participation of many important actors working on wetlands. I would like you please to turn on your cameras, those that are with us, so that I can thank you for your contributions, which were really great. This is a very interesting discussion, and I think that this gives a tone for our World Wetlands Day, which as you know, is focused on freshwater and how the conservation of wetlands contribute to that. And finally, I would like to thank all the participants that joined in Zoom and in YouTube, and also the contributions from the chat. And we hope that tomorrow you will be all celebrating with us World Wetlands Day, a day to think about these connections that all of you articulated in such a wonderful day. So with this, thank you very, very much, and happy World Wetlands Day.
Thank you, Martha.
Thank you, Martha.
Thank you. Bye.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you all. Bye.
Congratulations.
Thanks. Bye.